Welcome to this talk about SvelteJS. We'll see how we can rethink our existing front-end apps and probably use the patterns that Svelte introduces. Svelte is a framework for building UIs, and it's slightly different than the ones that we've been using today. I'm Umang, I'm a front-end engineer at Razorpay, and we've been using Svelte since its version 2 in production. I'd like to start the talk by speaking about few eras of JavaScript, so people who've been doing front-end for a while, you've all started with jQuery. jQuery just made it easier to manipulate the DOM, add classes, or add elements in the DOM. jQuery was nice because the browser APIs back then were very inconsistent and they were probably ugly to work with. Then came React. It solved the problem that jQuery had. With jQuery, we had our state all over the place. And React introduced us to things like creating our UIs in terms of components with their own managed state. And React also introduced patterns like composition, which are very helpful. jQuery and React both became very popular and gave rise to a lot of third-party plugins and libraries that people could use to create all sorts of different UIs. And when I say React here, this holds true for other libraries as well, like Vue, Angular, and so on. We started using SSR once we realized shipping our entire front-end app was not, as a JavaScript bundle was not very helpful because the user would end up on a loading screen for a while and it just wouldn't work with our SEOs. We need to ask ourselves what's next. Just like React made the libraries before it seem meh, what could be the next thing that would make React seem okay-ish? Our front-end apps these days take up a lot of memory because they have a runtime on top of them and they're probably too big to ship over the network. There's a startup that got funded in YC recently that runs Google Chrome on a data center and then streams it on your computer. How did we end up shipping front-end apps that were this memory intensive? Could the new framework that we think about solve these problems? Could it not have such a huge memory overhead? And could we ship smaller bundles to the users? Could the next framework be Svelte? You've probably heard about Svelte at JS Foo. It was mentioned a couple of times in the talks as well. And if you watched the Google Chrome Dev Summit last year, on day two, the folks at Google were comparing different frameworks and what they've done recently to increase their performances. When they mentioned Svelte, all they had to say is it's already super fast and there's not a lot that can be done in this area. I'd like to talk next about reactivity and spreadsheets. Spreadsheets run a lot of the business world and they're extremely powerful. Spreadsheets are super fast as well. So when you're working with a spreadsheet, if you change one thing, it doesn't take a lot of time to update the UI. Compare it to a lot of React apps that we end up shipping. If they have a lot of UI elements, if they have a lot of components that are rendered to the DOM, it becomes jankier over time. But we've probably never experienced this happening with spreadsheets. And spreadsheets are also super user-friendly. So all you have to do is enter math formulae or function and then things just work. Cells just start populating themselves. This is done by using a graph and it's called forward referencing. So for example, you have a cell B that depends on the value of cell A. There's a dependency that the underlying engine has that B depends on the value of A, and then every time the value of A changes, the engine knows that it just has to change the value of B and not re-render the entire thing and figure out what has changed. For example, we have a spreadsheet here. The value of cell D4 is a product of cells B4 and C4. And if we look at the graph from B4, B4 has an external, B4 outputs to D4. And similarly, C4 would also output to D4. But if you look at the dependencies of D4, it has two inputs and one output. So because the underlying engine has this graph underneath, every time the value of C4 changes, it knows that it has to go ahead and update D4. And because D4 has now changed, we have to go ahead and update D5 as well. We don't re-render the entire spreadsheet in memory and then figure out what has changed. This is also something that reactive programming uses. So in our traditional imperative programming world, if we had to define a relationship between B and A, B is always supposed to be A plus 1. Every time that we want to change the value of A, we also have to recompute manually the value of B. We have to declare that statement. Sure, we could abstract this in a function called set A, which would internally update the value of A and all its dependencies. But as the number of dependencies grows and as it goes deeper, if there was another variable that would depend on the value of C, writing all of these functions and maintaining them probably becomes slightly difficult. But what if we could use another operator that would allow us to define relationships like this? So if we had an arrow operator like this, which would allow us to say B is supposed to be the value of A plus 1, the underlying engine would be able to figure out the relationship between these two, and every time that you update the value of A, it would automatically update the value of B. These are probably two of the major propositions behind Svelte. Instead of the arrow operator, we just use assignment operators like we do now. And instead of re-render the entire thing and computing what has changed, we use, like spreadsheets, a dependency graph that tells us what exactly would be changing when we change a certain variable. The next thing is DX versus UX. So good developer experience obviously means we have apps that are easier to write and maintain and just reason about, or if we go through some component, we're able to figure out what it's doing. And good UX is when the user is trying to do something, they're able to get from point A to point B without a lot of junk or without unnecessary waiting times. Good DX and good UX don't necessarily have to be mutually exclusive, but as it stands today, they kind of are. Our React apps have become jankier. As it has more components, they become jankier, and it's just a slower UX for the end user. And this is especially true on mobile devices where there's not enough processing power. The animations are slightly jankier. It just doesn't work like it does on your machine. I have two snippets here. One is plain old vanilla JS, and the other is React. What we're trying to do here is update the name from an input field. The name is in an H3. So if you look at it from a perspective of what is easier to write and maintain, it's of course the React app, because we're able to think in terms of components and state. As it scales, writing vanilla JS for all of these components becomes slightly trickier, and the number of lines in our source also increases. So it brings a greater surface area for bugs to appear from. But which of this is more performant? I'd say the vanilla JS code, which is directly interacting with the DOM APIs, is more performant because there's no underlying runtime or underlying virtual DOM that it has to interact with. While with React, as the number of our components increases and we change something on the top, it has to figure out a diff all the way to the nth child in the depth of it and then figure out what has changed. If we compare these side by side, when an input event is fired, if you use the DOM APIs directly, we just go ahead to the DOM element and change the value. But if we're using a virtual DOM, we would have to update the state, re-render the entire VDOM in memory, and then reconcile and then figure out what has changed, and then actually go ahead and change that value in the DOM. So the last step that we do with the virtual DOM library is the only step that we do with the DOM APIs, which makes DOM APIs very fast for the users. But using a virtual DOM library with using the syntax that it provides is obviously better for the users, for the developers. It allows us to ship more features frequently. But what if we could have the best of both worlds? What if we had JSX, we could reason in terms of components, and we had all sorts of life cycles, so we could do asynchronous things, or we could perform side effects? But everything was compiled to native DOM API calls. This means we don't have a runtime. in our application, we don't have virtual DOM runtime, we don't have React or Vue or Angular, we don't have a reconciler that figures out what has changed. This is the primary proposition behind Svelte. Svelte is a compiler. The source code that you write goes through a compiler and a bundle is generated, and the code in that bundle interacts directly with the DOM. So instead of having a virtual DOM runtime on top of the DOM runtime, we directly interact with the DOM runtime. Because we're also not shipping a runtime, we have a smaller bundle size. React GZIP with React DOM is about 45 to 50 KBs, so we're saving up on that. And our apps also take faster, apps are also faster to bootstrap because they don't have to go through the entire overhead of virtual DOM stringification. I have this React code here, which uses the hooks APIs. It has a counter and it has a name. It displays the name and it has an input field to update the name. There's a button which has the count of the number of times that is clicked. And it has an on-click listener which updates the count by one every time you update it. The same component in Svelte can be written in just few these lines of code. We have a variable name. We pass in a default value. We have a count. We have an H1 that displays a name. We have an input element, but this time we've bound the value of the input element with that name. So Svelte, when it generates the code, it figures out that every time the value of the input field changes, we also have to update the name variable. And within button, we have an on-click listener, which increases the count by one. So if you notice the count plus one step, we're just reassigning the variable, and that's how reactivity works within Svelte. You don't need to call extra functions. Everything just works as reassignments. And if I compare them side by side, the Svelte code is fewer lines of code, and it's just closer to HTML, to what people learn when they enter web development than the React component. So this allows people who are not very proficient with building components using React or any other virtual DOM library, they've just learned HTML to write, to build Svelte codes. And this is true in the real world as well. Eliza was a developer at Spotify when she tweeted this. One of her product managers was able to make changes to a Svelte component just because it was closer to HTML and the product manager happened to know some HTML. But all of this is okay. It doesn't make sense if I don't show you a demo on how Svelte makes it easier for us to write apps. We have a REPL here where I'll show you how things work. There's some code that I can write here and output here. So basic templating in Svelte is just writing variables within curly braces. We can also add styles by adding a style tag. So I can say I want the H1 to have a color of blue. I can also use other components within my component. So if I have a greeting.svelte and it has an H1 that says hello JSFoo, I can go ahead in my main component. I can say import greeting from and I can render it as JSX here. This is not technically JSX, it's HTMLX, which is a superset of HTML, so I don't have to close my tags. It just works. If I had an input element, I could say bind name, bind value as name, and I wouldn't have to have a closing tag here. So now, the app has a name, which is bound to this input field. Every time I change this, this changes. But if you notice, the H1 that I have here, the color that I set, is not being applied to the H1 within greeting, even though it's being rendered in the same place. So this is something called as scoped CSS that Svelte uses. So when it compiles the CSS, it adds a computer-generated class to the tag, and then also to the style, so it's only applied to the markup that lives within the same file. If I got rid of this element, Svelte would show a warning saying a new CSS selector, and it would just not have this that CSS in the bundle, in the output, which means you don't end up shipping unnecessary CSS, and you're always able to see what doesn't work. So oftentimes when you're refactoring code, there's a lot of CSS that you don't know if it's safe to remove. But when you have these sort of features, the compiler itself is able to tell you that this CSS selector is not being used anywhere, and I won't just bundle it for you. I'll get rid of this. And what if you want to pass the name to this greeting component? I'll go back here. I'll use my templating. I'll say hello name. But I need to tell this component that it has to accept a name prop, which I can do using export let name, which means it's just expecting a name prop. I can also pass in a default value so that if this is undefined or if the consumer component just doesn't pass a prop, it defaults to world. I'll go ahead here and I'll use the shorthand way to pass a prop. Again, if I go back to result, it will just work. There are also conditionals and loops that Svelte has. So if I wanted to render this only when name had some value, I could do this else, and then I'll close my if block. I'll show the greeting only if there's any name available. If not, I'll ask the user to please enter a name. So if this is blank, the component just disappears. If not, it comes back into the view. This is probably not how you would want to build apps in the real world. If something was appearing or disappearing out of the screen, you would want animations and transitions to happen. So if I go here and I say import fade and slide from Svelte transition, I could do this come into the view by fading and then go out by sliding. So on the same app, it slides out and it fades in when it has to enter or go out from the DOM. All of this is compiled, all of this is shipped as CSS at the runtime. So any transitions that you see here are running off your main thread, so they'll not be janky or they'll not block your main thread. There's also a concept of computed properties. So if I had a style here, if I had a class, say green, and it has a color of green, I could have a computed variable here, which is supposed to become green only when name has a value of green. And if I wanted this H1 to have a class of green, if the value was green, with React, I'd probably do something like this. If green, set it to green, otherwise set it as an empty string. This makes sense, but as the number of classes that you want to apply conditionally to the same element grows, this expression that you have here, this expression grows in size and it just becomes slightly uglier. With Svelte, I can say class green, apply the class green, only when this expression evaluates to true. Again, back to these computed properties, what these do is every time the value of name changes, every time the value of its dependencies changes, it is recomputed. So this is where the forward referencing and the dependency graph come in. If I go ahead and look at the JavaScript output, if I go to the update function, if it says if the name has changed, if the name is dirty, invalidate the green value within the component and set it to the new value. So if the name is green, we add the class. How this works is if I set the value of this input field to green, it adds this class at runtime. This makes sense when you have multiple classes. If I had a class, say, color red, and I had another computed property, red is name equals red, I could go ahead here and I'd say class red. I'm using a shorthand here, so if the class that you want to use has the same name as your variable, you don't have to have an expression. You could just use a smaller directive and it would work again in a very similar way. You can also compose components. So instead of this text here, I could pass in a slot and from within app, I could have a greeting and I could pass in children. Each one is hello name. Oh, I don't need this hello name and it would work. We also have stores. Stores are global variables that you can reuse between multiple app, multiple components. So I'll create a file store.js. I'll import a write table from Svelte store and I'll export a store called name here. And within greeting, instead of having this prop, I could say import name from /store.js. And the way that we use stores within our components is by prefixing the references by a dollar sign. So I prefix them both here. And if I go back to my app, I'll also import the same name store here. I'll get rid of this. I have my name here and my name here. And again, it just should work. Unexpected token. Oh, thanks. Oh, illegal reassignment to export name. Oh, we forgot to change the reference here. So dollar, again, it works. Red, green, everything. Like the if block that I showed you earlier, there's also an await block that I find really helpful. It is used with promises. So if I look at this code here, I have a promise, which is get random generator. Get random generator just fetches a random number and resolves when it's done. There's a button here, and when I click on the button, it calls this function. What this does is just reassigns the value of promise to the new promise. So this is again reactivity in action. And in the await block, I can await a promise. And then once it's resolved, I can render something with its value. So while it's still pending, I can show waiting state. And once it's done, I can either show resolve. I can show UI corresponding to the resolve or UI corresponding to the catch. This works. You don't have to have a loading local state within your components. We also have life cycles for mounting and unmounting. So we have a life cycle called on mount, which is invoked when your component has finished mounting. We have a life cycle on destroy, which is invoked when your component is removed from the DOM. So all of these are helpful when you want to perform other side effects, network calls, or what have you, depending on the life cycle. We also have after update and before update, which are executed after and before Svelte has finished recomputing the new values when you reassign something, and exactly before they're rendered to the DOM. We can also have events. So I can add event listeners by onClick as a function that could be declared in the script, or I could have an inline function. But if I wanted to proxy or to bubble up events back to parent components within my H1, I could just say on click and it would bubble it up back to wherever it's being used from. So within greeting, I could say on click, alert something. Cool. So if I click, it alerts something. This helps you create event listeners back from any component. So we also have named slots, so instead of just one slot, you can have multiple slots. This removes the need for things like render props, because you're able to have multiple children and you're able to define where they're supposed to load. Back to the presentation. Cool. So there are some differences with React that Svelte has. Svelte is reactive by default and it's reactive by assignments. So it's more closer to the way that you write code. If you're reading code from top to bottom, reassignments would just make more sense. We don't need set states or set x hooks sprinkled throughout our code. Svelte is compiled to DOM APIs, which means there's literally no runtime. The DOM is our runtime. This makes it faster to push changes to the DOM and faster to bootstrap, because you don't have an underlying runtime which needs to recompute what has changed and then stringify the virtual DOM. You can declare CSS transitions, and it's a very short declarative syntax for that. You have these CSS directives, and all of them are compiled to CSS so that none of your animations are blocking the main thread. There's also two-way binding. A lot of people have different opinions about this. One of the key features with React was we only have one-way binding now. But two-way binding helps when you're trying to build controlled input elements or controlled forms. And the Svelte code is closer to HTMLX than JSX, so it looks very similar to HTML. People who don't know or you've not experienced writing components using React or Vue or any virtual DOM library would be able to read and understand what's happening in the code itself. We've been using Svelte since V2 at Razorpay. It's been about a year now. One of the major products that we use Svelte in is Razorpay checkout. There are several reasons why we chose Svelte for checkout. Checkout has to have a smaller bundle size. So checkout is the payment widget that we ship to the end customers, and that's where customers end up paying. It needs to have a small bundle size because not everyone is on 100 Mbps internet connection, and they might be on a 3G that works like 2G. If we're shipping, say, React on top of this, that would add another 50 KB overhead, which is almost half the size of checkout. And checkout needs to be fast. So 50% of our traffic is from mobile devices, more than 50% actually. And not all devices are high and they don't have the latest Snapdragon or 8 gigs of RAM. People have phones with 1 gigs or 2 gigs of RAM, and the payment widget appears within the apps that the user is using. So, which means it needs to be fast. Web views don't have as much power as our desktops do. Removing a runtime, a virtual DOM library, and then using just the native DOM API or the DOM runtime makes it way faster to apply updates, and is just easier on the batteries as well. And checkout should also not conflict with the merchant's code. So if you were to ship, say, React version 16 and the merchant's app was somehow using React 14 and there were some issues with sandboxing, we could have conflicts with the React versions and things would just not work as they should. Before Svelte, our checkout was built using .js, which is a templating library, and vanilla JS code. We had native DOM event listeners everywhere, and that increased the source code, the lines in our source code by a lot. And every time that someone new joined, they had to go through this entire app and reason about things in terms of native DOM API calls. But with Svelte, we've been able to, also our state was all over the place because we didn't have everything was DOM APIs and native HTML, and we couldn't think about Svelte. It had the same problems as jQuery did. Using Svelte, we have our state in place. We are able to think about our UI in terms of components, and we've been able to push twice as many features after shifting to Svelte than we did before, which just makes it easier for people to onboard and start building on top of the code base. There are several advantages, which means why you should be using Svelte. Svelte has a short and concise syntax, so we have small declarative derivatives for using classes and transitions. We have things like await blocks, loops, and conditionals. All of our transitions are compiled to CSS. Again, they don't block your main thread because it's all just CSS. They're never janky. Reactivity happens by assignments. It's easier to read through. We have scoped styles, so your styles can live with your markup and you don't have to add extra classes in your code and then namespace your components. It just works. It also tells you that these are the styles that are not being used. We're not shipping them to the end user. DOM is the runtime. There's no secondary runtime on top of DOM, so things are way faster with Svelte than they are with React. Because Svelte is compiled, our bundles are smaller, and we are able to ship as many features in the library as we want. So for example, if you're not using the transition directive, we just won't ship it into your bundle. If we're using another virtual DOM library, say React, and React had to include features around transitions, they would have to ship it to every user with every bundle, regardless of whether or not the bundle was using it. So we are able to tree shake the features that we don't need. And because of that, we can provide as many features as we'd want. But when wouldn't you use Svelte? There are certain drawbacks and reasons on why you shouldn't be using Svelte. You need .svelte files for each component. So with React, I'd be able to declare a local component, which I'm just using in that specific component. But with Svelte, I need a different file for every single component. Composition with Svelte is slightly different than with React. So it might need relearning if you only worked with React or other virtual DOM libraries. The bundle size increases with the number of components, but this can be worked around by using code splitting. The bundle size increases because each component is compiled into its own bundle and compiled into its own vanilla JS code, which has invalidate functions, event listeners, and things that watch the reactivity. We have two-way binding. It's completely optional if you're still in the immutable flow. If you don't like two-way binding, if you prefer one-way binding, you're free to use one-way binding. But if two-way binding makes things easier for you or difficult for you, you can opt in or out. There's no official TypeScript support yet. There are ways through which you can integrate TypeScript within your Svelte project, but you would need to spend some time wiring that up, and then if there are any issues with that, you'd have to work around them by yourself. People are working on adding TypeScript support, so it should be here pretty soon. There's also no proper testing libraries. The way that people usually test Svelte components is compile each component into its own bundle and use something like JSDOM or Puppeteer or Cypress. And because Svelte is relatively new, there are fewer plugins. If your app is dependent on third-party plugins for creating different parts of the UI and similar alternatives are not available for Svelte, you might want to steer away from it. Svelte version 3 is just 4 months old at this point. And not a lot of people know Svelte. So if you're building a project that has to be maintained by some other team or some other company, you might want to steer away from Svelte because the people that end up maintaining your app might not know Svelte and may not be willing to spend time to understand how it works. But if I managed to convince you about using Svelte so far, you can get started at the Svelte REPL, which exists at svelte.dev/REPL, or you can clone the template on your local machine, npmi, and then get started with it. There's more widths that has been built on top of Svelte. There's a framework called Sapper, which is also built by Rich Harris, who's built the entire Svelte app. Sapper includes things like server-side rendering, routing, and code splitting. So it takes all of the effort away from you and gives you a batteries included framework that you can use to ship apps to production and ship just generally faster. There's also a Svelte native project, which is built on top of native script, which allows you to create mobile apps using Svelte. This is faster than using things like React Native because a lot of the work is already done on the compiler's end and it doesn't happen on the user's end. So again, just like web, it's way faster on mobile devices as well. Thanks for listening to me. You can find more resources about Svelte at svelte.dev. There's also a nice tutorial there that guides you through every single feature that Svelte has. I can be found on @UmangHome at Twitter if you want to discuss anything about Svelte. Any questions?
It was really nice talk. I want to know that why to use this library when we have pReact where we can have smaller bundle size.
Sure.
And, why not to use pReact or other variant of Reacts where we can get smaller bundle size? Because
sure.
There are two things. First is we want the performant app, and the second thing is we want the smaller bundle size. But we can get both of those things from the pReact or other React variants, and then we can also get the whole React ecosystem for us. So why to use this library instead of the other variants of React?
Pre-act is smaller in size. It's just 3 KBs when you gzip it, but it also suffers from the same performance overhead of having another virtual DOM runtime that's running on top of your actual DOM. So if Svelte apps are generally faster than any of the virtual DOM apps that you have. Yeah,
okay,
that's a trade-off.
Just one follow-up question. What I think is that most people don't care whether their application is fastest. They just want their application to be fast enough. So I guess React is mature enough to provide us fast enough web applications. So I don't think there is much benefit of switching to it instead of the library.
Fast enough here is pretty subjective. Apps might be fast enough on a 16 GB Mac, but if you're running your web app on a POS terminal or on an Apple Watch, it may not have as much memory as your own dev machine or the regular users of your app. So if you're shipping B2B apps, you might not care about performance, but if you're shipping consumer grade apps like we ship checkout, which has to work fast on the end consumer's device, which may not be as powerful as our dev machines, it makes sense to have faster applications there. It's also more battery friendly if your apps are generally faster.
So, yeah. Thank you.
One thing I was concerned about is how is the state management community around Svelte? So React has Redux, Mobix, and all those particular libraries with it, right? That there's React Redux and there's a Mobix state tree for React. So for Svelte, how do you go about it when you have more state for a complex application?
I am not sure about the third-party libraries, but Svelte has support for context APIs, which is very similar to React's own context APIs, and things like store where you can have a shared state in a different file and then use it in the components that actually need it. But yeah, there might be other libraries around Svelte which are similar to React, but I've not used or searched about any of them yet.
Yeah. Hey, man, great talk. So just wanted to understand, what do you think is basically hindering mass adoption for at this point for Svelte? Like the points that you talked about, they obviously sound great, right? So like, why do you think the adoption at this point is probably not? Is it just the learning curve, or there are other factors as well?
It's probably not the learning curve. I'd argue that if you were just starting out learning how to create web apps, Svelte would probably have a less steep learning curve than say something like React would, but from what I believe, the two factors that hinder mass adoption right now is there are not a lot of third-party libraries that you can use that you might already be using, and Svelte is just 4 months old. Svelte 3 is just 4 months old. So there might be some issues that you might encounter as the library, as the framework matures, the adoption will definitely increase.
Okay, so do you recommend, like, so if I go back to my front end team, do you recommend making the switch at this point, considering the ecosystem is probably not that mature?
If you do not need third party libraries, and if you're just building something out that is not that intensive, if you're doing a POC that may or may not be shipped to production, I would definitely recommend using Svelte because it's a better experience even while writing it.
Yeah, hi. Your thoughts on web components?
I've personally not worked with web components, but if you are asking specifically in terms of Svelte, Svelte has a way to compile directly to web components. It has had support for web components since V2. A lot of its API slots is also inspired by how web components work.